Now, I talked a lot about the artistic side, sort of tapping into mathematical structures. But I think there's a flip side to this, which is one that I find very appealing as a mathematician, because I think that a mathematician is also driven by sort of very creative instincts, aesthetic instincts in creating their mathematics. One of the key moments for me at school to make the choice of becoming a mathematician was when a teacher, when I was about 12 or 13, suggested that I read a book by G.H. Hardy called A Mathematician's Apology. G.H. Hardy actually was one of the heroes of this complicité piece, A Disappearing Number. But he wrote this amazing little book. It's online, you can download it, and I really recommend you do if you want to try and understand what it's like to be a mathematician. Because he writes about mathematics really being a creative art. Here's a description of a mathematician in the book. A mathematician, like a painter or poet, is a maker of patterns. I'm only interested in mathematics as a creative art. And it's interesting that Graham Greene wrote about this book that it was the best description of being a creative artist after the diaries of Henry James. And for me, I think that really is true. Hardy very much talks about the mathematics that gets used to create new technology isn't real mathematics. It's not what motivates a mathematician to create the mathematics they do. We create the mathematics we do, in some sense, to create something which is beautiful, to tell a story. And as an example, one of the theorems I sort of love of Pierre de Fermat is the following one. He was able to prove that if you take a prime number and when you divide it by 4, if it has remained a 1, then rather amazingly, you can always write that prime number as 2 square numbers added together. So, for example, 41, prime number, divide it by 4, you get remainder 1. So, yes, that's true. But now Fermat says you'll be able to write that as 2 square numbers. So, indeed, 41 is 4 squared plus 5 squared. Now, there are infinitely many of these numbers, prime numbers, which have remainder 1 on division by 4. Absolutely extraordinary. What on earth have they got to do with these square numbers? And for me, it's not so much this statement. The statement itself perhaps isn't so interesting, but it's the journey that Fermat takes you on, or the other mathematicians have proved this in different ways, to be able to connect the world of primes to the worlds of squares. I mean, what on earth have these got to do with each other? But as you read the proof, it's a little bit like listening to a piece of music where the composer sets up 2 themes which you feel have nothing to do with each other. But as the piece of music grows and changes and the themes develop, suddenly you see them interweaving until they become the same thing. And there's a moment in this piece of in this proof where you just feel, now I see the 2 sides coming together. And it's the same kind of excitement, I think, that you get when you're listening to that point in a piece of music when you suddenly hear these things coming together. So I think there's a lot of storytelling at work and choices that are being made in what you do as a mathematician. So, for example, this is the kind of mathematics I create as a research mathematician. I don't expect you to understand everything that's on here, but what I'm obsessed with is the world of symmetry, and I'm interested in creating new symmetries out of the knowledge we have to date. Now, actually, I could get a computer to generate new symmetrical objects. It's not very difficult. But what makes a mathematician is somebody who makes a choice. Well, why are the symmetrical objects that I created exciting? I wanted to tell a story with these. These symmetrical objects combine 2 very different areas of mathematics. One is the world of symmetry. The other one is the world of something called elliptic curves, trying to solve equations like y squared equals x cubed minus x, quite related to things like Fermat's last theorem. Now, these 2 worlds didn't seem to have anything to do with each other. And the excitement for me when I discovered these symmetrical objects which sort of united these 2 areas was that there was a surprise, an aha moment. I could take in a seminar my fellow mathematicians on a journey and make them go, wow, God, I didn't realize that was going to happen. And I think that's absolutely key in the way that we create our mathematics. And that's often driven by a kind of aesthetic judgment. Now, of course, a lot of the mathematics we create then has an impact on the physical real world. New technologies are often created by discovering new symmetrical objects like this. But again, I think what's at work here is that both the creative artist and the mathematician are responding to things in the natural world. I will create new things, but it's not surprising perhaps that ultimately they may have some impact again on our place in the natural world.